Morning.
Page 110. And if you want, brother, just aim at the wall so the people out in radio land, what they used to call it, can sing also. The Highway of the King. Would you stand, please?
We're a band of bound for that home above, walking in the highway of the King. Our lips are filled with praises, our hearts are full of love, walking in the highway of the King. Walking in the highway of the King. Walking in the highway of the King. With hearts all full of praise, we're happy all our days, walking in the highway of the King. This is a grand old highway our fathers all have trod, walking in the highway of the King. The only way that leads us to heaven and to God, walking in the highway of the King. Walking in the highway of the King. Walking in the highway of the King.
Listen.
With hearts of full of praise, we're happy all our days, walking in the highway of the King. No unclean thing can ever pass o'er this holy way, walking in the highway of the King. No danger can befall us, we're safe by night and day, walking in the highway of the King. Walking in the highway of the King. Walking in the highway of the King. With hearts all full of praise, we're happy all our days, walking in the highway of the King. With songs of joy and gladness, the ransom now we see, walking in the highway of the King. With garments pure and spotless, and hearts from sin set free, walking in the highway of the King. Walking in the highway of the King. Walking in the highway of the King. With hearts so full of praise, we're happy all the days.
Sing the chorus again.
Walking in the highway of the King. Walking in the highway of the King. With hearts so full of praise, we're happy all our days, walking in the highway of the King.
Amen. Remain standing if you will.
Good to walk with the Lord this morning. Amen. Got a couple of things I want to read just real quick before we enter into prayer this morning. Sister Gayhart's heart oblation was unsuccessful. She will have an EKG on May the 8th, and if her heart is still out of rhythm, she will have a pacemaker installed on Thursday, May the 16th. They ask us to please continue to pray. So be in prayer for Sister Gayhart as far as her heart being in rhythm. God can absolutely touch that. Amen. You believe that this morning? All right. And then it says, Pastor Tony and congregation, thank you so much for the beautiful flower arrangement. It was greatly appreciated. And that's from the family of Brother Charlie Craig. All right. We have different prayer needs amongst us this morning. Maybe just by an upraised hand, he'd like to make some of your personal needs known. So thankful for a God, amen, not just a God, the God, amen. Thankful for our Creator that gives us an avenue to come and bring our needs this morning. I don't know how you come in this morning, but I can tell you right now, whatever your need is, God is a provider, amen. You come in spiritually loaded this morning with your hearts heavy and your shoulders full. God has a way of taking that weight off your shoulders, or at least help carry the load. So whatever your need is today, don't hesitate to bring it before God. All right, let us pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we're honored, Lord God, every opportunity that we have to come into your presence and to pray. We're thankful, Father God, for what Christ did, Lord God, that our sins could be lifted, that our souls could be cleansed, Father, and our feet could be put upon that solid rock, God, that we can come this morning, Father, boldly before the throne of grace, God. Father, we know that today, that whatever we ask, oh God, Father, nothing, Lord, that we deal with in this life, no circumstance, no trial, no physical trial, no financial trial, Lord God, no spiritual trial that we go through on this earth, Father God, goes beyond your reach, Father. We know whatever our need is today, Lord God, Father, you have a desire, Lord, to give us everything that we stand in need of. And so we thank you for that this morning. We thank you, Father, for the answered prayers already, Lord God. We're standing here today, Lord God. And Lord, as just looking around the room, God, many, many answered prayers right here today. We think of this woman that had arthritis, Father God. We're thankful, Father, for your hand, Lord God, Father, for touching, Lord God, and leading in the directions that need. Father, you do that time and time again, Father. We just want you to know we're appreciative of those things, God. And all of these hands that were raised today, God, you know every situation. Father, you know what your people come in with this morning, Lord God. You know those that are sitting at home watching online right now. You know the burdens that they carry, Lord God. And then across our nation today, Lord God, and all over the world, Lord God, there are saints, Lord God, that are carrying needs today, Lord God. And I think of that as we all come and bring our petitions, Lord God. We'll never, Father, exceed, Lord God, what you're capable of doing. So we just want you to know we love you. We ask, God, today that you'd move right here in the midst of your people, Lord God. We pray that you provide for the sick, Lord God, that you'd strengthen, Lord God, those broken in body, Lord God. We pray for the spiritual needs, Lord God, of your children. Help us, Lord God, in this day, Lord, to stand, Father, for the cause of Christ. Lord God, that we would indeed be a light to this world, Lord God, that we would, Lord, be that ambassador for Christ that you've called us to be, Father. We pray, Father, for the spiritual needs. We pray for the physical needs, the financial needs in this place today. Whatever it is, God, we pray and ask you to provide. Lord, may you anoint, God, and use our choir today, Lord God, the musicians, Lord God, every person, Lord God, Lord, the ushers, Lord, every soul, Lord God, in this place, everyone that puts their hand to the plow, Lord God, that you'd give each one, Father, the wisdom that they stand in need of. God, use Brother Tony and the anointing that you've given him to preach, God. Give him the very words, Lord God, of encouragement, of strength, Lord God, even chastisement, whatever's needed, Lord God, today, God, we trust you to provide it, Lord, through your man this morning, God. We ask you that your spirit would be manifested in our presence here today, Lord God. Exceed our expectations, Father. Do abundantly today above what we ask, and God will give you the praise and glory for all it's done. Father, we love you. We appreciate you this morning. We thank you, Lord God, for all that you've already done, for what you're doing this very moment, Lord God, and then what you're going to do. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
would never know how rich my life could be. And Lord, my willingness to serve is the least that you deserve for the blessings you have showered over me. So I will say,
this morning with this song running through my mind, and I was kind of singing it as I was getting ready for church, and I walked into the choir room this morning and I saw it was on the board, and Brother Sherm said, "Sheila, you think you can pull this song off this morning?" I said, "I've been singing it all morning." And the Lord just works that way sometimes, you know. We have a room full of burdens this morning, and this is where you lay them down, right here.
Amen.
You know, it's an easy place to do it. You can do it anywhere, but when you're in the house of the Lord and you have the saints here with you, it's just a really easy time to give them to Jesus. You know, he loves us and he walks with us every step of the way. And pray for me as I sing this song this morning. I've had a lot of burdens and I've laid them down, you know. God is so good to me.
Just bring your burdens to the
Let the righteous.
Wow, what a privilege we have this morning. Probably nobody in this building has gone through their Christian life without messing up a few times, without having to claim again the blood of Jesus Christ for our needs. What a mighty God we serve. Amen. Unbelievable. We don't deserve anything. We studied about in Sunday school this morning. All the things that we don't deserve, Jesus brought. And we don't have to go on cheated out of all the good things that God has for us. Amen. Turn to 126 in those little books. This song just kind of fits, and we'll take our offerings. We bring it. I thank thee, Lord, that I can cast my burdens all on thee. Though I be tempted, thou hast died to bear them all for me. There it is. I thank thee, Lord, that I can cast my burdens all on thee. Though I be tempted, thou hast died to bear them all for me. Oh, Jesus, I will cling to thee. I'll love thee more. I'll place my trembling hand in mine until the battle's o'er. Though tried and pressed,
Yet I will trust this one thing I can do. I'll lean upon thy loving breast. Thou wilt save me through. Oh, Jesus, I will cling to thee. I'll love thee more and more. I'll place my trembling hand in thine until the battle.
One more verse, sing it.
Though raging storms about me sweep and fiery billows roll, to thee, dear Lord, I humbly trust the keeping of my soul. Oh, Jesus, I will pray to thee. I'll love. I'll place my trembling hand in thine until the battle's o'er. Oh, Jesus, I will cling to thee. I'll love thee more and more. I'll place my trembling hand in thine until the
Amen. Rachel has a song before the message this morning.
David sang the praises of the glory of Jehovah. Paul preached that always lost, save knowing Christ. Little John said it is precious. By leaning on his bosom, so for a moment may I humbly testify. Did I mention that I love him? How I worship and adore.
I want to say. And did I mention he's been faithful to every promise he's ever made me? I love him. That's all I want to say.
Good morning, everybody. Want to welcome everybody that's joining us via live stream. Glad that you have joined us. We pray that you receive a blessing this morning from the Word of God. This has happened many, many times. The singers would sing, and some would testify, as Sheila did this morning, and she said, there's a room full of burdens. And then the Lord woke her up with this song, and sure, I'm not knowing what song the Lord woke her up with, he had the same song on his heart. Burdens, problems. And it just so happened when I started, had a late start this week, getting this message prepared, the Lord just so happened to lead me along the same lines as burdens. You see, folks, that's why we don't have a program. Johnny, good to see you, brother. God bless you. We don't have written programs 6 months in advance, because God's not good at being contained or corralled by programs. The Bible said, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. Not liberty to act foolish, not liberty to jump over the pews, not liberty to go around doing unseemly things. There is a comely liberty. There is a Holy Ghost liberty. And the Spirit of God will never put you into a position or into a motion that is unseemly. And the reason we don't have a program, it's not because we're just trying to be different. We just happen to believe in Holy Ghost leadership. We happen to believe that whoever came in this morning, God and God only knows the burdens on those hearts. God only knows the load they're carrying. God only knows how many are ready to throw the towel in. God only knows how many are frustrated and don't know what to do. And God knows if there are anybody here that wants to take his life. So you got to go with the flow. You got to go with the Holy Spirit. Because if the Spirit of God is leading us, it's a home run every time. Somebody's going to get help. Somebody's going to be blessed. And how I thank God that we can come in not knowing what we're going to do next, what song we're going to sing, if anybody's going to testify, what the preacher's going to preach, what the players on instruments are going to play, who feels impressed to do this, who feels impressed to do that. But we know this. Everything, if God is leading, will be done in decency and order. And that's what allows us to walk out of every service and say to ourselves, wasn't it good to be in the house of God? That song was just what I needed to hear. That sermon was just what I needed to hear. Amen. I said to one of my deacons a long time ago, I said, there's somebody out there in the aisle fell asleep. Go wake him up. He looked at me and he said, you're the one to put him to sleep. Philippians, the fourth chapter. Philippians, the fourth chapter, beginning with verse 11. Tell me this text wasn't built into the framework of this service. Now that I speak in respect of want, not that I speak in respect of want. Paul's saying, you know, I'm not complaining. I'm not being aggravated. Not that I speak in respect of want. For I have learned, in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. Paul is saying, for I have learned, whether I'm down and out, in and out, whether I'm on the verge of a nervous breakdown, whether I don't know which way to turn next, he said, I learned to just stay cool and leave everything in the hands of God. And if you are walking with God, that's a wonderful feeling. And you get that sense that as long as God is in control of your life, all things work together for good. Whether they be good, whether they be bad, God is taking all the raw materials of our lives, all the heartaches, all the ups and the downs, the ins and the outs. And when he's through with the product, you will come forth as gold tried in the fire. Listen to the next verse. I know both how to be abased and I know how to abound. Everywhere in all things I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Oh, I can't do that. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Well, I can't forgive this. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. I can't raise these kids, but I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Many people find it difficult to believe the power that Christianity offers to a world of lost sinners. The power to conquer sin, Satan, the flesh, the world, and in the end, conquer death. That's the power that's available to every sinner out there. And don't you listen to these preachers that are standing up all over America saying and bragging and boasting, and in some cases covering their real perniciousness. I sin, you sin, and we all sin. Don't you think for a minute that Christ is going to be a minister to sin? Don't you think that for a minute that the Holy Ghost of God, and when you are imbibed by the Holy Ghost of God, the Father comes in, the Son comes in, and the Holy Ghost comes in. You think those three are going to ride in a body that's pernicious, that's sinning, that's got all kinds of issues and baggage? No way, Jose. No way. And I'm not saying that arrogantly. I'm not saying that disrespectfully. I'm saying it because the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. If the gospel can't straighten you out, nothing can. But God knows what he's doing. Tragically, Christianity means to many believers no more than a mental consent to believe in Jesus Christ, or to ascribe to a creed, or take on a denominational label they wear, or joining a church, or accepting a ritual rite or a ceremony that they've experienced, or being raised in a Christian home, they think they become Christians by proxy. And so the world has come to believe that having a form of godliness while denying the power thereof is acceptable to God, and nothing could be further from the truth. If you got a form, you don't have what you need. If you have an appearance of religion, if you have a pious look, if you have all kinds of crosses around your neck, if you got baptized so many times the fish know your zip code, nothing makes you saved but the blood of Jesus Christ. The forms of Christianity are many, but as some of us know well, and we thank God for it, the Bible confirms that all these forms leave a man untouched in the personal depths of his life. Oh, the damage and the deception of the forms of false religion. The religious world would like to ignore, and this is what bites me. The religious world ignores the most amazing transcendent quality of holiness that visit our world in the flesh in the form of Jesus Christ and is now imparted into every soul who accepts his saviorhood. If you accept Jesus Christ, he comes in with power. Jesus said, tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with power. Don't try to witness. Don't try to do anything except the Holy Ghost gets a hold of you first. Then ye shall have power to be witnesses. I'm telling you something. If the blood of Jesus Christ can't clean a man up, nothing can. Nothing will. And I'm excited about it. Because there was a time when I loved to sin. And I thank God I realized at an early enough age that was just making my life more miserable. That was adding weight to my shoulders. So Sister Sheila, thank you for that song. Sherm, thank you for that song. And God, thank you. Thank you. And to God be the glory. He knows what he's doing. And what a contrast the Bible makes over and over again between professing Christianity and saved Christians. Just listen, the New Testament is full of verses. Why call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? Straight is the gate, narrow is the way that leads to life, because wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. Again, two types. Love not the present world, but rather taste the good world of God and the powers of the world to come. Set your affection on things above, not on the things of earth. There is a huge difference in the New Testament between believers who love the status quo of this present age and Christians who have tasted the powers of the heavenly gift and been laid hold of by the hopes of the world to come. You see, here's the difference between who's saved and who isn't. One's got their heads in the cloud and the other's got their heads all down here in the world stuff. Not that you don't appreciate, not that you shouldn't have good things. God is going to bless you. God's going to bless you, and God blesses everybody with common blessings. But don't let God fill your arms up and fill your life up and fill your heart up with his goodness, with his blessings, and then you begin to forget about God. That's why when they came out of the Exodus, and Moses told them, look, you're getting ready to go. And you're going to live in homes you didn't build. And you're going to reap the harvest of vineyards you didn't plant. Amen. And you're going to drink from wells you didn't dig. But after you have drank and after you have eaten and after you're full, beware not to forget the Lord. That's what happened to America. Stuff that's going on in America is just stupid. The Roman New Testament, Roman civilization was brilliant and it was glittering and it was attractive, just like our own. You try to raise a young child today and he gets exposed to all the medias, all the programming, all this, all that. Something inside of him rises up. I want that. I want to look like that. I want to color my hair like that. I want to mark up my body like that. I want to dress like that. What we don't understand is this world out here, like that world back in the days of Rome, with all its brilliance, is a fatal attraction. It's an attraction that's making mothers and fathers wear themselves out, worry themselves sick, because their children, something has got into their children that makes them want to do all the wrong things. You got your hands full. But you can do all things through Christ, which strengthen us. Thank God. Listen to the gospel, saints. The brilliance of this world can so get into your hearts. You can walk away. Hear me. You can walk away from your father's business and never know it until you lift up your eyes in hell, just like the man in the Bible. I know what I'm talking about. 5 or so years ago, there was only one thing on my mind. 28 years or so of pastoring, I thought, it is over. And I was thinking about constantly enjoying the winters in Florida, running around with everybody to flea markets, eating in every restaurant they can find, playing golf in 80 degree weather right through November to April. Then I thought in the summertime back in Ohio, I could visit all the sites. I can go see my families. I get to see very, very seldom. And I can go visit here and I can go visit there. And then I thought I'd throw a little bone to the Lord and say, oh, Lord, in the fall, I'll do a couple revivals here and there. And I said to myself, soul, take thine ease. You got sufficient laid up for many years. Eat, drink, and be merry. But God. And I told you about 3 months ago, but I didn't go into detail. I've told some people. I had one thing on my mind. I've been preaching 28 years, 30 years, now 31. I said, okay, that's enough. I don't want to strangle the work. 4 o'clock in the morning, God woke me up. I woke up praying. And this is what I was praying. Lord, I hope you're all listening. And I know you are because I can see, you know, my dog's ears go up, they go, oop, oop, oop. When the dog hears the wife come in, oop. I was praying, God, I'm getting at the age where things are a little more difficult. And I said, if you If you want me to go, I'll go. If you want me to leave, I'll leave. And I don't know when. Only God knows the future. But I said, if you give me the strength, and more than that, I need the inspiration. And more than that, I need for you to give me messages. And I said, I'll keep preaching until you're through with me. That's where I left it. You know why I left it there? Because Father knows best. Father knows best. But I'm only making a point that this world can so get into our hearts that we can walk away from our callings, from our service, from that thing which God has given us to do. We can gather up our talents and walk away from it all. And think that we're doing God's will. The world is so much about us, and the attraction is so fatal. What did Paul say? Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world. This present world is spiraling, going down the drain right now as we speak. And only God knows what the future of America is. But I know God has given America another chance. And I think we're on our last round. But whatever the future holds, I'm going to hold on to God. Amen? Listen, no believer ever needs to be a failure. No believer ever has to be left behind. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. I celebrate the resources this morning of Christian power to see a man through the battle of life. No wonder John said, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And if faith in God means such things, now in the world, how in the world do men try to live life without God? How do they survive the blows of life, the ugliness of evil, the ghastly shame of man's inhumanity to man, and all the disheartening moral failures of humanity, and the impact of death and disease and personal sorrow upon our lives, and still keep their morale up to fight another day? I celebrate the power and the resources of the Christian life. I found something that will keep every one of us going no matter what happens. If Paul knew what was going to happen to him in his ministry, you read in the Corinthian letter what happened to him, how many times they tried to kill him, they beat him like a dog, he was left in the sea to drown. He had enemies. He had all kinds of problems. That man had more trouble and more enemies than Carter's got liver pills. But he said, I learned something. I learned something. I learned that whatever state I'm in, whether I'm up or whether I'm down, I learned something. To be content. Because godliness with contentment is great gain. Oh, thank God for that this morning. Nero is upon the throne. Paul is in prison, and the gospel for which Paul stood would outlast and wear down all the Neros and all the pagan empires of the world. We, saints, can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth us. What enables a Christian to have such enduring power in this world? Isn't it always associated with the experience of being captured by a cause which is greater than ourselves? Isn't that the first thing? Why do you think the communists are so successful? Why do you think all these crazy religions and all these people and crazy governments are so successful? Because they've been captured by a cause. Why do you think old Bernie, he's been captured by a cause. How many of you heard Diamond in Silk last night on Fox News? You don't have a phone? Oh, okay. That's a good point. Well, anyway, poor Bernie, he's been captured by a cause. Everything in the world is free. And guess what? You all gonna pay through the years for it. My point is, you get captured by a cause. The disciples got captured by a cause. A cause that was bigger than themselves. A cause whose ideals and dreams were bigger than their own. And when you get captured by a cause, when a living God can set up shop in your heart, you're captured by a cause. And God will give you the grace and the strength to see that cause all the way through to the end, no matter what the opposition is. An object of devotion which one sees to be more important than oneself. So let's unpack verse 13 and we'll let you go. Look at the revelation of moral strength and power in those two little syllables. I can. There is all the difference in the world between the I can life and the I can't life. There is all the difference in the world between the I can life and the I can't life. How many souls is the devil holding in bondage and crippling the progress of Christianity because they've become convinced they can't do this or that? They can't do what God is asking them. They're afraid of what God might be calling them to do. And so they have been brought into captive to the I can't life. The I can life is one of victory and gladness. The I can't life is one of defeat and depression. You can't believe how good it feels to be in Jesus Christ, thoroughly equal to all the opposition, all the pressures, all the physical, moral, and spiritual issues going on in life. You don't know what it's like. If you're saved, you know what it's like. You, at times, through Christ, feel invincible, not in your own strength, but in Christ's strength. And it's a wonderful thing to be able to walk through a world, a howling in it wilderness, where voices are yelling at you on the right, yelling you on the left. It reminds me of Christian as he was coming through the city of destruction and he was trying to get to the celestial city and he was trying to escape the city of destruction. And he said, Bunyan said, he put his fingers in his ears. He wouldn't listen anymore. And he kept walking through the city of destruction. Life, life. Life, eternal life. That's how you get through it. And it's a wonderful feeling to know that you and I can walk in a God-forsaken world, in a fallen world, and we can walk through it. And we know there's something within us that makes us stronger than that something that's trying to knock on our doors and come through our windows. And that something is Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, thank God. You can't believe. If you're saved, you can. And many Christians would find their spiritual life more vigorous and satisfying if they just knew how to rest their nervous system a little more. When we are living the I can life of spiritual victory, our whole spirit and soul and body are refreshed. Nobody feels spiritually refreshed losing battles day in and day out to the flesh. Nobody feels like they're inspired and on top of things when they're losing one battle after another. How many Christians are pathetically, wishfully thinking, I wish I had more gifts of the Spirit. I wish I understood more of the Bible. I wish I was raised in a Christian home. I wish I could be like so and so. They are so saintly and so stable. I wish, I wish, I wish. Yet experience has shown that when such coveted possessions become ours, we often find that which we had thought would be golden advantages were really disadvantages. And what we thought were our own disadvantages were in reality disguised opportunities. The point is this: the true Christian position in life is to accept that which God has appointed for every one of us, whether it be good, whether it be bad, whether it's in between. You and I have to learn the secret to victory, and that is we can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth us. Have you ever read, were any of the New Testament writers ever said, oh, do you think Paul ever said, oh God, I wish I were the emperor of Rome. I would make Christianity the national religion. Can you imagine Peter saying, if only it was a doctor of the law, I could straighten out all those crooked Sanhedrin? Or do you think John would say, if I were a leading statesman, I would make loving one another as brothers and sisters the law of the land? They didn't live like that because they knew something. God wants you and God takes you right where you are. Whatever baggage you got, whatever personality you got, whatever nationality you got, thank you, Jesus, whatever. I'm looking forward to heavenly meatballs and spaghetti. But wherever you are, the problem with so many Christians is they want to be somebody else. God doesn't want you to be anybody else but who you are, where you are, and exactly what you are like. He wants to take you with all your handicaps, with all your idiosyncrasies, with all your baggage. He'll take you right where you are, on ground level. And when he gets done with you, you're going to be amazed what he can do with a man or a woman who is surrendered to his power and his spirit. Amen. Such signs and wishing spasms are absent from the New Testament because it's through our weakness and through the thorns in the flesh and through our disadvantages that Christ can be glorified through our weakness. God gets more glory out of you and I being weak when people were telling me, God's calling you, you're going to be a pastor. I said to myself, you people are crazy. If you knew what I was like, you'd understand. I'm amazed. I stand back in amazement that God was able to use me in whatever capacity he wanted to use me. We go to high school, my twin brother goes to high school reunions. They just had one the other day. My twin brother, the kids that I went to school with, they say, how's Tony doing? And my brother says, he's a pastor. He's been a pastor for years. They fall down on the ground laughing, because they remember what I was like. I remember what I was like. And I just have to look up to God and say, to God be the glory. God, I don't know how you got anything out of this old Italian, but you did. Thank God. So what I'm saying is, be who you are. Be what you are. Don't try to be like the world. Everybody's trying to be like everybody else. Everybody's trying to look like everybody else. Be who you are. Be as God created you to be who you are. Amen. Someone says, I want to live the I can life, but I don't know how to do it. Well, this is how you can do it. I can do all things through Christ when I allow him to do all things through me. So now the question becomes, can I or can't I? The true enablement for Christian service is in our willingness to submit to the lordship of Jesus Christ. Many of us are engaged in Christian work of some kind or another. If we are not, why not? Are we saying, I can't? You see, this verse takes away every excuse for every bench warmer. I can't. I can't do what you want me to do, Lord. Oh, you can't? Did you ever stop to think what he did for you? Did you ever stop and think of the glory and the splendor that he left and came down here and was beat to death and nailed to a cross for you? How can you say, I can't? The truth is, you won't. Because none of us is going to come to the judgment and say, God, you know my problem. You know my wife. You know my husband. You know my handicap. You know this problem. You understand. Get out of here. I never knew you. Take a walk. I never knew you. Folks, we're dealing with God. We're dealing with somebody who knows our thoughts afar off. We're dealing with somebody who knows our motives and our intentions for every word, for every look, for every expression. God sees us from the inside out. And it's that God that we have to deal with at the end of the road. And for those of us who are serving, are we productive? Are we really winning? Are we having an impact upon souls, or are we in the lukewarm class barely surviving? Are we seeing the results that we want to see? If not, are we now learning to tolerate those disappointing results? Is anybody saying, I just can't do anymore? I guess I'll just have to accept defeat. I guess I'm just like my mother. I'm just like my father. I'm going to have to be who I am. No, you don't have to be like anybody else. Be like God wants to make you. Or are there still some who have the spiritual drive to confront their obstinate challenges and they look at the future and they say, I can. Everything depends on whether we have learned the secret of our text. And the secret is, I can. Through Christ. There was an old man that got saved. They told him to read the book of Philippians. He was reading the book of Philippians. And he got to this verse, Philippians 4:13. He was reading. And part of the verse was on the other page. And all he read is, I can do all things. And he said to himself, Paul, you went too far. Paul, you conceded. The Apostle Paul, you went too far. And then he turned the page. Through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Somebody said, you don't know me. No, I don't. But God knows you. And guess who else knows you? The devil. You and I, believe it or not, can do all things through Christ. Sheila, can we shoulder this burden? Can we shoulder the weight? Can we shoulder all our heartaches, all our sorrow? I can do it. I can shoulder the load through Christ, which strengtheneth me. That's how we do it. That's how we stay on top. That's how we can say and pray and glorify God and say holiness unto the Lord. Because the God who saved us is the same God who empowers us. Everything depends on whether or not we have learned the secret. But if we keep looking at things on a purely human level, the spiritual challenges are going to look like Goliaths to us. And when that happens, you're going to see your own insufficiency so clearly, you're going to say to yourself, I can't. Some of us, Sherm, get ready. Some of us need a fresh revelation and a new start. A burning bush encounter where we can say with renewed zeal, I can through Christ. The God who made little baby Moses, the strong champion of the Exodus. The God who made little David, Goliath's biggest headache. And the captured Daniel, the prime minister of mighty Babylon, and transformed Saul into Paul, and Legion into a missionary, and Joseph into the world's largest food rescue operation. Don't tell me you can't. God can take every one of us from the very lowest level up to the highest level. You see, if you keep looking at it through your eyes, through your ability, through your talent, you're never, ever, ever gonna get there. Just as I am. That's how God wants you. And don't let this fatal attraction out here start working its way into your heart, or you'll walk away from God and never know it until the moment you open your eyes in eternity. Do you realize you can do all things through Christ because he can take the littlest thing and make it vibrant in his hands. Moses said, I can't talk. I stammer. I stutter. Come here, Aaron. Moses said, I can't deliver all those people from the mighty Pharaoh. God said, what you got in your hand? A stick. Let's go. Good enough. Amen. God wants you just the way you are. He'll clean you up. And then he'll equip you. And then he'll empower you. And then you will be amazed of the things that you can do through Christ. Somebody said, I can't stop. I can't break my habits. No, no. You don't want to break your habits. You're enjoying them too much. You let Christ have control. He can do what we can't do. Amen? You can do all things. Your simplest words can become a two-edged sword if Christ is in it. The one vital condition is that we guard against anything which may interrupt our fellowship with God. That's the key. As long as you have contact this way, you're going to have influence that way. As long as you maintain a relationship with God and keep it alive, God is going to flow through you. There's going to be times you're not even going to realize it, but he is going to work through you. And whatever you do, whatever you can do, whatever you attempt to do in God's will, he will bless it. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. I'm closing for sure. Here is the heart of the message. You now have strength to bear your burdens. You now have strength and grace to bear your burdens. I can carry the load now through Christ. I can survive this divorce through Christ. Brother Griffith, Sister Polly, I can go on living after the death of a loved one. I can go on fighting the battle. I can conquer all my addictions through Christ. I can clean my house. I can clean the pig pen up through Christ. I can cut my lawn now after 3 months through Christ. I can pick up my dirty underwear and socks and walk them to the hamper through Christ. And the lady said, some of you ought to be shouting. I'm single. And I'm raising a house full of kids. I can do all things through Christ. I can be a better spouse. You got obligations, spouse. You all got obligations. You came to an altar. You got married in front of a preacher. And you were gushing and you were crying and you were dressed up pretty. By the way, we had a large wedding yesterday. It was good. It had a little bit of everything in it. One of the bridesmaids was coming up the aisle. She fell on the steps. She laid there for 15 seconds just laughing. We didn't know whether she was hurt, had a heart attack or what. The bride come down the aisle. She was singing a love song to her husband. The family that we married with three kids. They have been here and they're planning to attend here. It was one of those nothing can go wrong weddings, but it had a flow to it. But we come to an altar and we say, we take our vows for better, for worse, for this, for that. Listen to me. Let me just say something. You got responsibilities. And don't put your spouse in jeopardy because you got issues. Enough said. I can conquer my handicap and still do a work for God through Christ. I can conquer my bitterness, my unforgiveness, my hatred, my jealousy, my gossip. Paul says, I can conquer my imprisonment. I can conquer Nero. When I look through my cell, I don't see bars, I see stars. Because I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. What Philippians 4:13 is saying is, no matter how grievous, and I'm not minimizing anybody's pain or misfortune, but no matter how grievous your trials are, no matter how inhibited your handicaps make you, every trial in life has a ministry in it. Every life has a ministry in it. Every life has a purpose of God in it. And the word strengtheneth in our text is the present continuous tense, which means strengthens and goes on strengthening. Yes. Yes. An emphatic yes. We can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth us. You hear me? You can do it. Somebody said, well, you don't know how bashful, how shy I am. You can do all things through Christ. If you just trust him, if you just let him, if you just yield to him, he'll take you right where you are. And he'll fill your heart with the love of God. You'll like people you thought you never could like. You'll love people. You'll love one another. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. I thank God we're serving a God like that. Some have already come and prayed. Maybe there's others who would like to take a moment. And if for no other reason, just come down and thank God that he's been so good to you. So would you like to stand? You've been a good audience. And if anybody needs to pray before we leave, Sherm's got a song. The altars are open. God bless your hearts.
147, 147.
God bless you, ladies.
I yield to thee, Savior, forsaking
whisper.
My
whisper it in your own heart right
from
now. I can do all
things now. I
through Christ
will
which strengtheneth me.
To thee I surrender.
God bless you this morning.
For mercy I call.
God bless your heart.
Come take the first place in my heart.
Beautiful song. Listen.
Oh, take the first place in my heart. Oh, take the first place in my heart. I open the door, come in, I implore. Lord, take the first place in my heart.
You see, folks, it's so important that we cooperate with God. God sees it all. He knows it all. But you got to help God help you. God wants to help you. He wants to inspire you. He wants to empower you. But you got to come to the place where you recognize where you're breaking down. If the world's getting too close, if the world's trying to wind his way into your heart, if attitudes are starting to take away the sweetness, the kindness, if things in the past got you so eaten up alive that you can't function today and even hear what God's trying to do in your life, you got to come to the place. Every sinner's got to come to the place, or everybody that's having an issue has got to come to the place where they say, "You're right, Lord. You're right. I'm messing up my life. Two-thirds of it, half of it is already over, and I'm messing it up. I don't have a lot of time. But I know that you can restore all the years that the canker has destroyed." No, wherever God gets his way with you, oh, you're gonna love it. You're gonna feel it. And the rest of your way is gonna be a blessed and a joyful experience. Maybe there's a few others. One more verse, sir, and we'll let him go.
Oh, come, gentle Spirit, don't lead me, I pray. From thee,
Bonnie.
I will Bonnie. Never depart. I come to thee now, for I cannot delay. Lord, take the first place in my heart. Oh, take the first place.
God bless you,
in
sweetheart.
My heart.
Anybody else?
Oh, take.
That's all he wants, is first place.
Place in my heart. I open the door.
Don't lose your sensitivity to the Word of God or the Holy Spirit.
Lord, take the first place.
Don't lose your softness to the Holy Spirit, because he's the last voice in this generation. In the gospel dispensation, it's the last voice you're going to hear. The last pleading you're going to hear is through the gentleness of the Holy Spirit of God. And if you reject that voice, there is no hope for you. Just the chorus here.
Oh, take the first place in my heart. Oh, take the first place in my heart. I open the door, come in, I implore. Lord, take the first place in my heart.
Sister Carol sends a card. Her husband passed away. My understanding is, Beth, she may attend here in the evenings. Sister Carol is talking like she'd like to come and visit with us. She has a beautiful soprano voice. She said, the plant is gorgeous. I will cherish it. I send my love to all the saints at the Church of God, Lincoln County. Thanks again. Okay, you all dismissed in the name of the Lord.